of elliptic Lagrangian solutions of the classical three-body problem via index theory. Professor Long.
Thank you very much. So firstly, I would like to thank the organizers, especially the Marcello and all the local people for inviting me to give this lecture. And since the IMPA is certainly leading the unit on the dynamical systems in the whole world, so instead of giving a survey on what we have done, I planned to give a talk on what we just very recently finished. So this is a joint work with two of my former PhD students. Xi Junhu now is a professor in Shandong University, and Shan Zhongsun now is a professor in the Beijing Capital Normal University. So we shall talk about the stability of the elliptic and Lagrangian solutions of the classical three-body problem using the index theory. So I shall try, firstly, give you a brief review of the Lagrangian solution, tell you what it is, and also give you what is new, what we did, and what is my idea in our study. So for the three-body problem, it is a very classical one. So this is certainly very well-known, the formulation since the Newton. And so this is the Newton equation, and U is the potential of the potential energy, and given by the, for example, the Mi, Mj are the masses, positive masses at each point. And Q, we use Q1, Q2, Q3 to denote the position of the three points. And Qi double dot, that means so we use as the second derivative in terms of the time of the position, so the acceleration. And then it is well known that one can solve such problem using the variational method, since it has a large variational structure, and the action functional is given on the top. And the space here we are working on is that the space we are working on is a space. We consider the points moving in the R2. Each one is in R2. We have three of them, but we don't want any collision. Therefore, we hope to, at any time the Qi is not equal to Qj. Whenever this I is not j. So this is a solution found actually by the Lagrange in 1772. He actually wanted to find out a solution which is homographic. That means at any time, the solution, the three points are always been similar to a fixed figure. Therefore, he considered such kind of the solutions. The Q of the T is given by the phi of the T times Q at zero. So phi of the T actually is a scalar function. So then after you plug in this form of the solution, of the function into the equation, then you sold out the Q0 should be a central configuration in some sense. That means it has to be a spatial figure. For the three-body case, either it is collinear and solved by the Euler a long time ago, or that is must be equilateral triangle found by the Lagrange. And the phi t must be a solution of the two-body Kepler problem. Therefore, if we want to look for the periodic solutions, then phi of t must be given as an ellipse. So that is the solution found by the Lagrange. I don't know which one. Can this work? I don't know. The pointer? Okay. Somewhere? Okay. So one can see that from the top. For example, the largest triangle, you can see the M1, the Q1 located on the right-hand side, the lower the corner, and M2, M3, and so on. Then when it moves, every point actually runs along is on the ellipse. And at any time, thank you very much. Okay. So, for example, this point run along his own the ellipse. This one run along this one. But at any time, these three will form an equilateral triangle. And also, the point is that the center of the mass is one focus of the three, common focus of the three, the ellipse. And also, all the eccentricity are the same. That's very important of the solution. And such kind of the motion actually found, observed by people, by the specialists long time ago. For example, here, one is the sun. Since in the case, so would be Lagrange, the masses are arbitrary, whenever it's positive. So this is a sun. We consider the mass center here, and the Jupiter, the mass center here. Here is a group of small the stars called the Trojan, and we consider the mass center here. And at any time, they always form an equilateral triangle. So this such kind of motion actually exists. So the main concern in our this study is that we consider the linear stability of the problem. And classically, this already been known that this actually depends on two variables, two parameters. One is beta, we call that. Beta should be the 27 times M1, M2 plus M1, M3 plus M2, M3 divided by M1 plus M2 plus M3 squared. So one can compute easily that no matter what is the value of the M1, M2, and M3, the beta should be always located in between 0 and 9. So if it is 0, that means at least two of them should be 0. One of them is non-zero. And the eccentricity is certainly in between 0 and 1, and never get to 1. And we denote the Lagrangian solutions by the Q of the sub-index, depends on the beta and the E. We just use the ELIs for short later on. And they denote J by the classical, the symplectic matrix, and the U, the unit circle, on the complex plane in this talk. And then this the second order system can be written into a first order Hamiltonian system. That means we write the Hamiltonian as the kinetic part, energy part, plus the potential part. And so use this one to write the equation. Then this Z will be the velocity part, P1, P2, P3, and the position part, Q1, Q2, Q3. So we still have a 12-dimensional Hamiltonian system. And then we do the linearization along this Lagrangian solution. We denote that by Z sub the beta and the E. So Z actually given by the beta, the Q dot and the Q itself. So this gives us Hamiltonian system with still working on the 12-dimensional the space. And then it is well known that the fundamental solution of this the system actually is a symplectic matrix path in the, actually here should be in the 12-dimensional symplectic path. And it satisfies the equation, because for example, we denote this by cosi, then cosi dot should be equal, should be given by the J times the H double prime along this orbit, then times the cosi. And at the initial time, they should be identity. And then we consider all such the passes in the symplectic groups. Then for the study of the linear stability, actually we are interested in the endpoint of this path. That means the cosine beta E at the time 2 pi. So we consider such matrix. So in order to define the linear stability, we consider this one. And suppose we denote this matrix by M, then we say M is spectrally stable if all the eigenvalues of the M is located on the unit circle. And this is linearly stable, that means all the eigenvalues are located on the unit circle. And also, this M should be semi-simple. And equivalently, this can be interpreted as the supernorm of the every iteration of the M should have this, the supernorm on this bound. So this should be finite. And we call M is strongly linearly stable if the, for every matrix nearby, near close enough to the M, it is linearly stable. So that is the definition of the stability. Then we can see that. And another thing is that in order to study the linear stability, we need to know the distribution of the eigenvalues of this M. So for every symplectic matrix M, we know that the, no matter what is the dimension here, then the eigenvalues always distributed in such a way. So one is of always of even multiplicity. Negative one is also of even multiplicity. And if the E is eigenvalue on the unit circle, which is not real, then E conjugate should also be an eigenvalue, and both of them are of the same the multiplicity. And for example, if the B is the real number, which is an eigenvalue, then reciprocal of the B is also one. And they also have the same the multiplicity. And also another case is that we have four tuple of them. So if A is an eigenvalue, which is outside of the unit circle, outside of the real nine, then A bar and A inverse and A bar inverse, all of the four form a four tuple, and they also have all the same multiplicity. They should be also possible eigenvalues of the matrix. So there, in this case, one can say that since we are, or we want to study the linear stability, therefore we want to consider what is the possible ways for eigenvalues escape from the unit circle. So there are three ways. One is goes through eigenvalue one. So if two eigenvalues got to the eigenvalue one, then it's possible one go to the positive way and one go negative way, get away from the unit circle. Another one is goes through the negative one. The fourth case, the third case is the, we call that the crying, the collision eigenvalue. That means we have double eigenvalue E, a double eigenvalue E bar. Then they split into the two here and the two here. So we get the such kind of possibilities. So we want to study all these three possibilities to get the linear stability. So this is the simplest case. If the eccentricity is zero, if the eccentricity is zero, one can see that this actually three points are moving on circles. And the focus of the ellipses becomes the ellipses becomes circle. Therefore, there is only one center of the mass the center. So they actually doing the circular motion around this center. And in this case, the linearized Hamiltonian system become very simple. And later on, we can see this one actually can be solved. And in the earlier days, people already studied this case and also using the perturbation method, studied the case whenever the eccentricity is very small. So based upon computation of this case, one can get this case. Another thing I should mention is that since we got a 12-dimensional Hamiltonian system about the linear stability, and we want to reduce as many as possible dimensions using first integrals. So we have the integral of the momentum, we set it to be zero, and we have the integrals of the center of mass. We also set this one to be zero. And the angular momentum also preserved. Therefore, this can be set to be zero. And the integral of the energy also is a constant. So with this, the integrals, we can cut down 7 dimensions of the system. And for the last one, since we are considering periodic solutions, so the zeta actually is a solution of the linearized Hamiltonian system. Therefore, we can cut down another one. So theoretically, we should be able to reduce the problem to a 4-dimensional one by canceling these 8 dimensions. And this was done nicely, excellently, by the Mayer and Schmidt in the Cincinnati. They published a paper in 2005, gave excellent symplectic the coordinate change, which makes everything reduced to a 4-dimensional one. And we call that one the essential part of the problem. And the rest part for the other 8 dimensions actually depends on the Kepler solution of the two-body problem. And that one can be solved explicitly But this one is very hard. So in the next page, we see what they did. So this is what they got. So in their paper, they showed that after such a reduction, the problem is reduced to this 4x4, the coefficient matrices. And we get the four-dimensional Hamiltonian system. The linear stability depends on actually the fundamental solution of this system, and especially the endpoint of this fundamental solution is the crucial point. We want to understand how the eigenvalue of this one distributed. From this one, actually, we can see this is a very simple, in some sense, the system. But since this one, whenever the E is, if E is zero, then all the cosines disappear. Then you get a constant system. Then theoretically, using the Fourier theory, you can solve everything out. Since the dimension is very high, in some sense, the four-dimensional has already been higher enough for us. Then using computer, you can get out the fundamental solution, and you can compute it out if E is zero. But whenever this E is not zero, then this actually depends on the T periodically, and there's no satisfactory theory for this to know the eigenvalue of the endpoint or the fundamental solution. How do they distribute it on the complex plan? So this turns out to be a very, in some sense, a subtle problem. In 2006, Simo and his co-authors published three papers on this problem around 2004 to 2006. And they actually computed the case. I should also write here. They actually computed the case. For example, whenever this eccentricity, this line is the beta, the horizontal axis is beta, runs from 0 to 9. Vertical line is the eccentricity, runs from 0 to 1. And the red ones means they already been solid or analytically proved. So the stability of this part is known. And then they computed. They also, under certain the non-degeneracy assumptions, they computed the case when the beta is precisely 6 and the E is 1. And they showed in this case, studied the hyperbolic case here. And they showed there should be such kind of the curves. Numerically, all the blue ones and the green ones are computed by numerical method. So they showed in this part, double E means the elliptic eigenvalues. Both two of them, there are two pairs of them located on unit circle minus the real 9. And for this part, it means one elliptic eigenvalue, one hyperbolic eigenvalue. Hyperbolic one actually in this area is negative. Here you got two hyperbolic ones. They are actually also negative. And here you got another two pairs of the hyperbolic ones, which are actually positive. And this part gives you the four tuples of the, I missed one bar here. Maybe this case, maybe this one, the complex hyperbolic one. This means four tuple here when outside the unit circle and outside the real nines. So they actually predicted, in some sense, computed the how these curves should be distributed. Okay? But the rigorous proof only given for the bottom line and go a little bit up by using the bifurcation theory and the perturbation theory. And actually, we are not aware of the rigorous analytical proof for such kind of the stability for the major part of the rectangle. And also, I should mention that for the Lagrangian solution, this is already well known, that for the variational point of view, then the solution actually is minimizer of the action functional on the loop space of the homology class in the space we consider it. And therefore, the Morse index is zero. This is also an important point, a starting point of our study. So in our case, we needed to consider kind of the normal form of the matrices. We are interested in this study only for the 4x4 matrices. So this is for the eigenvalue located on the real 9, which is hyperbolic, not positive 1, not negative 1, not 0. And the rotation matrix, eigenvalue located on the unit circle, not real. And this is for the eigenvalue positive 1 or negative 1. This is a special one. Also, eigenvalue located on the unit circle, but it cannot be reduced to this case. And this is special, the four-dimensional for the eigenvalue negative 1. We shall see these cases. So that means the every matrix in the four-dimensional space can be, 4x4 matrix can find out a P, which is this black 4x4 matrix, so that this M is conjugated by this P to the or the smelective sum of these matrices, or to this one, whenever it's a 4x4. Certainly, we shall see details of such things later. And then the Hu and Sun, they completed a theorem published in Advanced SI Maths in 2010. They showed that the z to the z beta e means the elliptic Lagrangian solution. And the 2 on the shoulder means that you go around this curve twice. That means that we call that the second iteration. For that iteration, you can compute the Morse index. They're able to show that this Morse index is actually in between, always in between 2 and 4. And since it's the integer, therefore, there are only 3 cases, either 2 or 3 or 4. And in the second theorem of their results, they claimed that if this matrix, that 4x4 matrix, takes square, is non-degenerate, no eigenvalue 1, then according to the value of this iterated Morse index, you can know the stability in some sense. So is the 4 is linearly stable, is the 3 is linearly unstable, it's 2, then there are 2 possibilities, whether it's linear stable or maybe not. So we want to understand this part. Since this is, in some sense, already gave some answer, but for the selection mechanics people, they actually want to know how the stability depends on beta and E, instead of depends on this Morse index. They actually do not know this Morse index at all. So we want to carry out this computation further to see how this linear stability can be represented by the beta and the E. And actually, we want to realize whether this picture of the symbol is correct or not. So the way is that the... So firstly, since we need to use index theory, we give you a very short the introduction of the index theory for symplectic metric passes. So we consider SP2. For SP2, we have a power decomposition. So this part is positive, definite, symmetric, and symplectic. Therefore, it can be written into R, Z, Z here, and 1 plus Z square over R. The R is always positive. Then the second part should be symplectic and orthogonal. Therefore, this is rotation matrix. So in this case, one can easily see that the R, theta, and Z actually correspond to the cylindrical coordinates in the R3. And since R is positive, the z-axis is digged out. Then we find out we are interested in the eigenvalue 1, in the case of eigenvalue 1. Then you compute that, you get if the 1 is the eigenvalue of the m, that means the coordinates should satisfy this equation. So this gives you a hypersurface, the kind of surface in the three-dimensional space. So we show that, I show that to you. So this is the hypersurface for the eigenvalue 1. And this axis is x-axis, and the y here, and the z here. And then, for example, this blue one is the singular surface. Then for this blue one, since we have a path, for example, the red one is the fundamental solution of the problem we are considering. So it should start from the identity and go away from here, then maybe intersect this surface several times. And in order to simplify the drawing, we cut off this whole picture by the plan, the z equal to 0, to write this one much easily. So we get this picture. Then there's a natural orientation of the hypersurface, and we do it in this way. And for this, the fundamental solution, since the initial point is located on the singular surface, we pull it back a little bit to the matrix 2 and to the 1/2 of the diagonal matrix here. Then we define the index actually to be the intersection of this path. with this singular hypersurface, whenever this endpoint is not located on the unit circle, not located on this singular surface, then this is well defined in the homotopy sense. And similarly, one can do this for example, here, this is definition. And for the nullity, we define it to be the dimension of the kernel of this one. And this is the green one. You pull it back a little bit. And this should be SP2N. I missed that. And then for the degenerate one, you take the minimum value of the index of the path, which is non-degenerate and close enough to this the given one. And similarly, for every given omega on the unit circle, you can do the same thing and define an index for them. So this is the picture for the singular surface, the negative one. Negative one, just you fold the positive one, the singular surface to the top. You get a symmetric one for the negative one. Then the index here, you can easily compute out, for example, for this path. Should it be start from zero here, when you pass it through, you get one. Go to here, you get two. So respect to the eigenvalue negative one, this path should have index two. With respect to the eigenvalue one, this is for the eigenvalue negative one. For the eigenvalue one, you get the zero here and the one here. Then you get two here. Then come back, you get one again, and so on. Now the point is that for the problem, first we need to do a modification of the problem. Since the original equation is not corresponding, is a one-dimensional, is a four-dimensional once order the Hamiltonian system. Therefore, we need to transfer it to a two-dimensional, the second order Hamiltonian system. So we multiply this, the given, the fundamental solution by a 4x4 matrix path. This R of the T is the rotation matrix. And this, since R of the T, this matrix takes value at the 0 and the 2 pi, the identity. Therefore, we do not change the endpoint. Therefore, the study of the linear stability of the original one can be done by studying this one. And then when it turns out this one is much simpler. And for this one, actually, you compute it out, you find out the coefficient matrix of this one. Then you find out this one actually given can be reduced to a two-dimension, to a second order, the so-called linear operator on the periodic the boundary conditions. So we consider this one corresponding to the gamma. So, and in many cases we need to study the boundary value problem is given by the omega here. Omega is a number on the unit circle. And then the first step we need to study. So in order to study the whole area of the parameter, the rectangle, we need to understand the four boundary values, the boundary, the segments. Then our computation is that for the first part here, we get the I1 for this part, I1 of the gamma beta e. Beta now is zero. This should be zero. And a negative one of the gamma zero e for every e, this should be two. So this is the, for example, we denote by the purple one here. And for this part, we computed this part actually is the hyperbolic one. So this here, we also get I1 of the gamma 9 e, this should be zero, I1, a negative one of the gamma 9 e. This should be zero. And then we computed this part. For this, we are mostly interested in the negative one index. So negative one index here should be, negative one index should be two here, and should be zero here, and should be zero here. Okay? That's our the computation, since the actually it's not a trivial computation. One need to carry out carefully for every step. Because of time, I should skip that. That means for all the three boundaries, you can understand the situation completely. You know how the eigenvalue located, and you know how the normal form of the matrices should look like, how it should be look like, and you know how the index in terms of eigenvalue 1 or in terms of negative 1 or for every the omega on the unit circle, you can compute them out. So that's the basic preparation of our study. And then the most important, the technical lemma is the following. So we consider the second order, the subordinate joint operator, which depends on beta and E. We rewrite it like we factor this, the square root of 9 minus beta out. So we write this one as the square root of 9 minus beta times A hat, a new operator. This operator is given by the A of the 9E divided by square root of 9 minus beta with some the matrix here. It's a 2x2 matrix. And then one can see that the beta only appear in this part. So, but this one can show that A9E actually is positive definite. Therefore, suppose we have an eigenvalue of this A hat, then we take the derivative with respect to the beta of this eigenvalue, then we found that the derivative, since then you can multiply, I forgot to multiply this side by the eigenvectors, okay, then take the inner product. Then after you take this derivative, you found the eigenvectors takes unit norm, therefore appear with only this part, actually. So this part actually is positive. Therefore, that means along every eigenvalue, then if you go with this beta, then the negative one can go up, become positive one. The positive one cannot go down, become negative one. So along each one, each fixed this, for example here, we fix this E here, and you go this way, then the eigenvalue will increase. And the Morse index is just the number of the eigenvalue of the operator. Here is a 9, the real 9, and here is 0. The Morse index is just the number of the eigenvalues below this 0. So this is I1 of the gamma beta E. Okay. So that means the Morse index essentially will decrease when you increase this beta. So the first theorem we obtained is the for every beta and E, actually the nullity is always 0 whenever this beta is non-zero. So it's non-degenerate in some sense. And also the Morse index is always 0. This is already given by the original methods. So important conclusion is this part. If beta is 0, this can be easily computed. Should be the kind of the degeneracy should be 3. So we have all the eigenvalues are 1 if beta is 0 on this vertical segment. And whenever you get into this square, everything is non-degenerate. So the proof is the following, the essential idea of the proof. I already showed you the eigenvalues will increase. So suppose we have 1 which is 0, since this is increase, so nearby, we can find out nearby this the beta 0. We can find out the beta, which is rather close to the beta 0. And for that one, we shall have the eigenvalue. The Morse index will be positive. We shall find some negative eigenvalues. But this is not true. This will contradict to the original assumption. The Morse index should be 0 for the periodic case, for the solution. So this gives us a non-degeneracy. After we get that, we see that then the eigenvalues, whenever they are located on the unit circle, if they want to get away from the unit circle, there are only two ways. Either get out from negative 1 or the crying collision eigenvalues. So the negative 1 becomes very important. We need to study the case for the negative 1. But for the negative 1, we know that we already computed the two sides. This side, we have the index to be negative. For the negative 1 index, this should be 2. This should be 0. And we know the index actually is non-increasing. When you fix this is the E. And that gives us a very good estimate on the how it will change. So actually we have a theorem. In this picture, in this the rectangle, we found three curves. We denote that by gamma s, s for small, and gamma m for the maximum, and gamma k for the crime. And the three curves look like this. This one is gamma s, this one is the blue one is gamma m, the green one is gamma k. And later on we shall show these two curves are actually analytic. They bifurcate out from the three-quarter differently, therefore they are different curves. They might have the intersections, but the intersection should be isolated. And we know this one starts from one, therefore this one is certainly different from this one, and we know this one is always located on the right-hand side of the two, but we do not know whether finally they coincide or not. And we are able to show that the linear stability of the problem actually precisely changes when the parameter passes through these three curves. So this picture actually essentially coincides with what Simo did. And we do not know this curve. This curve are for the separation of the hyperbolic one. Oh, no. So for the linear stability, we are not care about this curve. Since all of them, everything on the right-hand side of this curve are hyperbolic. So we only care about this curve and this one and this one for the linear stability. So in this sense, we already solved the linear stability completely. So we actually try to give a method which can work analytically for the linear stability thoroughly in some sense. So how to define these three curves? The idea is the following. This theorem says that since we already told you that if you fix E, and then you go along this horizontal line, increase the beta, then the negative one index should not increase. But this is integer valued. And we know it takes value 2 here, and it takes value 0 here, should have two jumps somewhere. That means it jumps here. Here we get the first jump, we get the second jump. Here we get from 2 to 1, and then from here, from 1 to 0. So for every E, you found these 2 points. Certainly, we did not climb. They are different. They may be the same. In that case, like this one, here you get 2, here you get 0. Immediately jump to 0. So, and we have another lemma to show that whenever this jump happens, the negative one must be an eigenvalue. And it is impossible to jump at somewhere which is not has no eigenvalue negative one. So then actually we are able to show that these two curves are analytic using the operator theory. So I already told you the idea of the proof. For the last the curve, actually we study the case. So for this curve, this one, maybe I should write. For this curve, which is located actually on the right-hand side of this, this is gamma m, this is gamma k. This one is gamma s. And we know that on the right-hand side of this curve, everything should be hyperbolic. So a priori, by the computation of the Simo, that suggests such kind of results. And everything on the right, on the left-hand side of this curve must be non-hyperbolic. So, but we need a way to prove this claim. The way is that we still use the main lemma. So we define this gamma k, this beta gamma, beta k, to be the point which such that on the left-hand side of this one, everything has eigenvalue on the unit circle. And we denote gamma k by this value and respect to also this E, and consider this curve. This curve certainly is there, one is proved whether this is continuous or not. And then we show that this point actually is also give us by the left-hand side, as actually the boundary curve of the hyperbolic one. That means on the right-hand side of this point, everything here is hyperbolic. And the proof is the following, idea of the proof. Still depends on our minima. So that means, suppose we have this one. For the beta 1, this is positive definite on the domain. And for example, pick up any omega on the unit circle. Then we show that every beta 2, which is bigger than beta 1, should also be positive definite, using the similar argument of the minima. And we show that eigenvalue, if this one is locked on the outside the unit circle, then here also locked on the outside the unit circle. Therefore, the hyperbolic region actually are connected. On every horizontal line, whenever this is hyperbolic, then everything after it should be also hyperbolic. But we know this line, vertical line, is always hyperbolic. So the hyperbolic one actually are connected to each other. Therefore, we can define the boundary point set of this hyperbolic one. Then one need to show that this boundary point set actually is continuous. This is a non-trivial task. But because of time, I should omit that, maybe. So there are several things. Also, we want to show this finished the part for the existence of the gamma k. Then we need to prove the continuity of this. Also, we know this this gamma is depend on the beta is for fixed E. Fixed E in the 0, 1. And this one already been defined. We know this is less than or small to be to the beta M. And this is less than or small than the beta K. And we show this one. Actually, this one actually go to 1. Go to 0. E go to 1, increase to 1. Therefore, this two have to go to 0 too, since it's bounded by this one. So that one also needs a proof for this estimate, for these three curves, they have to go to this point. And that also depends on the index theory. Since from the variational point of view, what the information we can get is only this one, the eigenvalue, the Morse index of the eigenvalue one. And from that, we can derive out everything else. And after that, we need to show that separated by these three curves, for each domain separated by this one, should have the property, the stability property we want. And the method to prove that is that, for example, we climb. For this part, whenever you are located on the left-hand side of this gamma ice, then the negative 1 index should be 2. Here should be 1. Here should be 0. This is just the firm definition of the curves. And then use this information, the index information, we are able to show that from this part, every matrix actually is conjugate for this one, first part, is conjugate to two rotation matrix. And the theta 1 and theta 2 is located in between pi and 2 pi. Therefore, we know precisely how this one behaves. And therefore, it must be strongly linearly stable for the open domain. And also for the second one, we do the same thing. The method to do that is that we consider the next page. For example, we consider the case. We want to study this one should be strongly linearly stable, this area. So there we know the negative index is 2. Then using the index theory, we can compute out this one should be given by the eigenvalue 1 index plus the split number at the eigenvalue 1 and another two possible the eigenvalues on the unit circle until the negative 1. A priori, this may not appear, may turn out to be 0. But we know this is 2. And we know this is 0. This is 0. And then also this one is 0. Therefore, we know since this is located in between of these two curves, so no eigenvalue 1 and no eigenvalue negative 1. So these two parts should be 0, only left with this one. But for this one, we know the maximum, since this is negative, every such kind of split numbers are integers, either 0 or positive integers. Therefore, the whole thing should be bounded from above by the sum of these two. And for each of them, the upper bound should be 1. Therefore, the total sum should be at least 2, at most 2. Therefore, this whole thing should be precisely 2. If this is 2, that means we have 2 eigenvalues on the unit circle. And from the computation of split numbers, we can locate the angle on the unit circle. How big is this angle? So that gives us the precisely understanding of the linear stability of each open domain. The next task is to study the case for all the boundary, all the linear stability on these three curves. So for we need to consider the possibilities, whether these two are equal or not equal. If they are not equal, the first case, we know the first one. So something located like this red point here must have the normal form, look like the negative 1 eigenvalue here, like plus a rotation matrix. For example, there, that means the N11 here, N1 negative 1, 1, plus a rotation matrix. So this actually is equal, defined by the way, the negative 1, 0, negative 1, 1, and the symplectic sum with the rotation matrix, cosine theta, negative cosine theta, sine theta, and cosine theta. Okay? So we know this is actually spectrally stable and linearly not stable, since this one, when you iterate, this one will pad up. But this one is certainly a stable part. So for this case, and one can do this carefully one by one for the case if these two are different, and also if they are the same but different from the third one. And all of them are different, you consider the middle one. If this one is the case, consider the middle one, and so on. The last one, for example, is if all these three may be equal to each other for the last one. But essentially, by the same way, we can do it. So that means using this method, we already classified all the situation and understand the linear stability rigorously. But what we do not know is the following. First thing is that the precise location of these three curves. We know the endpoint, which should be 0, 1. This 2 should start from the 3/4, and we know the bifurcation out, the angle of the bifurcation out, and we know precisely the angles. And for this one, we also know the starts from the 0, 1, the point here. But we do not know whether these two intersect each other. And we also do not know whether this one actually, after a certain time, just coincide with the blue one or not. And also, we want to classify, for example, in Simmel's computation, although it's numerical but it's suggestive, whether one can find out a way to distinguish the real hyperbolic and the complex hyperbolic. Since we are using the index theory in terms of the eigenvalue on the unit circle, it's impossible to detect the situation here. And also, we believe our method may be applicable to other problems. Since the elliptic Lagrangian solution should be considered to be the simplest solution of the actual periodic solutions of the n-body problem. And so this is the kind of our attempt to study the linear stability by using the index theory. Okay. So this is a different curve. Okay, thank you very much.